it. Drummond by close.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. going at it at 20,000 pounds. And we're doing the turn, 45 feet, side time, and the front of it. All the front runs across the promised men. Contract on this maneuver with Derek Fryer. Get your cameras ready.
Thank you.
23-44. Delivered to the Royal Air Force 45 and saw an action with 183-4 squadron. Very much towards the end of the war, then transferred to the South African Air Force. And then after the war, the system scrappers that are taking these days, but now restored, and restored not far from here, by airframe assemblies to stand down, UK and Ireland. Piston and ductless in December 2005. And it's now facing the biggest.
The development of the Spitfire was simply extraordinary. By the end of the war, it carried an engine producing more than twice the power of the original. Its maximum takeoff, weight, and range time are all doubled. Its firepower had increased by a factor of five, and its maximum speed had been increased by a third, all in a
up and down the crowd in front of you this morning. He's just passing vital weather information back to the control safety team back here in the box. And they're allowing... He is allowing them to make some safety decisions for the display. And we've just had some good news. Liam is now repositioning out to the right. This is Tucano Display, supported by Babcock International Group, to provide engineering and ground support to the Orion Tucano fleet at its home in Orion Blinton on Ouse in Yorkshire. And a team thanks go out to them for helping us make this display possible. Keep an eye on Liam, now running back towards us. He's about to break back onto his display line. During this manoeuvre, Liam is feeling the blood in his body rush to his head as he's fighting hard to keep the aircraft level around the sky. The team would like to give thanks to another couple of companies for their support this year. Special thanks go to Breitling Mountain Equipment and Osprey Europe. Now as Liam runs in from the right-hand side, he's about to perform a four-point roll. This is a great opportunity to get a look at the belly of the aeroplane. We have the Aria Brownells paint on the underneath. I don't think it's alien or the Orleans Benevolent Club logo, but the team also gives huge. This is an example of one of many manoeuvres taught all students as they progress through basic fast jet flying training. And it teaches young aviators the handling skills required to appreciate complexities involved when dynamically flying. Now repositioning the aeroplane to perform a high G turn. He's about to pull 4.5 G, that's 4.5 times the force of gravity. He's going to pull hard back on the stick and perform a very tight turn. During this manoeuvre opposite to his outside turn, he's going to feel the blood in his body rush towards his feet, and he's going to have to test his legs and stomachs hard now as he pulls around the sky to keep the blood back up into his head where he needs it. During this manoeuvre, as Liam completes the turn, I joined the Royal Navy after my A-level studies. Now fairly early in both our military careers, at the ages of 27 and 24, we have the opportunity to operate the display team for you here today. Now, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, 2019 is the very final year for Tucano operations, and this is the very final fly pass coming up for Bournemouth as we're off to Northern Ireland this afternoon. So, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, he's made it in against the adverse weather, so I'd like to hear a huge round of applause for the 2019 display pilot and the 2019 Royal Air Force Tucano display! Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it's been a pleasure to talk you through the display today.
Gentlemen, please give a warm welcome to the Black Cat.
Chris introducing some aftertaking fare, flaring the aircraft and climbing it up to a height of 600 feet, taking 130 knots of forward speed, converting that all into climb energy. Pausing for a moment before conducting a nose over. Going to 90 degrees nose down, getting a face full of ocean and conducting a left turn. Chris will now perform a number of 180 degrees wing overs, a manoeuvre that allows the aircraft to change direction rapidly, and demonstrating the high maneuverability of this brand new helicopter.
Working very hard here to just fly this sort of pattern. Uses a bit of the fuselage, would you believe, to help keep the aircraft in the air as well. It is, of course, Richard Goodwin in the muscle.
Heading for the world's most iconic World War II aircraft, performing something not seen, certainly in this part of the country, for many, many years. John Gowdy in Nellie B, otherwise known as the Jug, in that massive P-47 Thunderbolt with an R2800 engine. And what a great significant sound that is alongside.
great issues putting a team like this together is
the sheer expense, unbelievable value you're seeing in the air today, but also very expensive. Three more phases to come. Stand by now for the break.
Beautiful noise coming from the most numerous American fighter ever produced, known as the Jug, a hugely successful high altitude escort and in its own right a formidable ground attack aircraft. Joint control suite there of Nelly, originally built in 1945 at the Republic's Evansville factory in Indiana. The aircraft was built originally as a P-47D-40RA. The detail of its service with the US Air Force is a little unknown, although it did serve with the Air Training Command during the last few months of the war and was eventually stored at Tinker.
Incredible machine. I was chatting to John, by the way, last night, and it's just about twice everything, the Thunderbolt, twice the weight, twice the power, and twice the amount of fuel. It's got a massive oil tank in it. I didn't realise. I buy a big Pratt & Whitney radio myself quite often, and we're always putting oil in it. This one, the oil tank alone on the P-47 is 33 gallons of oil. Good grief.
So the Mustang.
Basically rebuilt the family T9 when Richard was very young, and of course a great thing to inherit within your family. Richard first flying it when he was just 23, and now together with his expert pit special biplane air displays as well, becoming very much a significant member and leader of the Warbird air display fraternity. But let's not forget Andy Durston, who's flying that and very excellent as well. So you can get to fly in the Mustang, the ME-109 Bouchon and the Spitfire. Bespoke packages are available for you to fly in these machines. Take part in a dog. Our heads into a spin now because it is the maestro of unlimited aerobatics, and it is his great fun. It's a superb aeroplane. He calls it the Massive Fits because it's hugely upgraded. Please give a massive Bournemouth welcome to Richard Goodwin in the Ultimate Pit Special, the Muscle Biplane. This up gradually throughout the course of the display. He's got several interesting maneuvers in his own inventory, the double hammerhead and a pinwheel. You'll see all of these, as well as the standard stall turns, flick rolls, the odd launch back as well. But hanging on here now to what is left of the residual power in the propeller and the engine itself. Bit of smoke on, he's going to let it drift very slowly, but it's still in control. He's not flying the aircraft. Well, I say he is, but it's not flying normally, is it? It's hanging there, but it's got so much power because this has got a massively uprated engine in it, an 8.5-litre six-cylinder engine producing 300 horsepower. Now, Pitt's synonymous with aerobatics. A big grunting drone coming up just about now, and then he's going to use as much of that height and energy to put in a few more rolls, tumbles, and that's what we call a lomchevac, otherwise known in Czechoslovakia as a headache. While he's up there, though, he may as well use what's residual movement there's left using on aircraft.
Joining JT in the cockpit today is 2019 Flaco pilot,
Flight Lieutenant Aaron Kerry.
Aaron joined the Royal Air Force in 2008 and subsequently completed his rotary flying training.
He joined the Patriot Force in 2015. He's seen operations in the Middle East, in Iraq, and more recently returned from Operation Nuclear in support of our French allies in Mali.
And now, those of you in the right hand end of the beach,
you'll see the aircraft pulled up by 30 degrees into the offset right hand wing over. This time, JT can look out his right hand window, coming back round to capture that display line, picking up the correct airspeed and running back in towards you. And as you close it in, you can hear that waka waka, the sound of the Chinook, synonymous with the aircraft.
And it leads to our popular Twitter hashtag, Blade Flap. Carrying up to 40 fully equipped troops.
We also carry vehicles, freight, palletized cargo, inside and outside of the aircraft. And one of his best known roles is probably in medical emergency response, a role fulfilled under fire in Afghanistan and made very popular. The aircraft goes back out to the left then. He's going to perform another 30 degree wing over. This is really a challenging maneuver, and Aaron's
an eye on JT's pitch angles, his roll angles, his high line speeds. He's glancing out the left-hand side of the aircraft, he's talking in background to that display line. Now, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, with that done, it's time for the crowd centre nose over.
So for those of you with your long length
cameras, do make sure you've got them ready and waiting
as JT pulls the aircraft to 45 degrees, nose up again.
This display you see today, inside of the
Aaron is the distance to run by the next manoeuvre, and that's how they keep the people together. Get Patrick JT around the sky. You see them out on our right hand side now, up into another pedal turn. Chinook's been used continuously as a battlefield helicopter for over 37 years now, most recently in Iraq, in Afghanistan, and now in Mali. Its heavy lift capacity combined with power, speed, and agility
ensures a rotary platform is second to none, delivering Her Majesty's Forces maximum effect anywhere in the world.
The quarter mile to the right of the display datum.
JT is going to focus on returning the aircraft to the hover.
You'll see Baker put down the orange hand. His arm will be tired at this point. He'll stow that away. He'll unclip himself. He'll run up to the front of the aircraft and reattach himself up back to the front for the next manoeuvre. About the latest edition of this aircraft is the autopilot hold which JT's just had in to keep his height over the sea. That enables him to focus on other bits and pieces, and has meant that they can keep that exact height as they go left to right in front of us today. You'll see him release that hold now though. He's going to pull power, put it to the left pedal, and he's going to take that Chinook skyway into the Gordy corkscrew. I've got 800 feet. And for those of you at this right hand end, you can just see the effect of the downwash of the Chinook on the water. And they're making that
spray on the top, but it's now very nice to see out of the
last weekend we're displaying this summer. We've got one more display in Jersey in 2 weeks, and we've had a great season. We've done so alongside our operational and frontline deployment commitments,
and we've been conducting all of our regular duties, training and tasking. The aircraft is going to run back in towards you now with the nose low, accelerates towards you here at crowd centre before breaking away hard to the left.
And for those of you down on the beach again, this time you may well feel the sound of the Chinook.
Again, this weekend,
the Strike Master pair.
It's going to be very dynamic, and we'll show off the aircraft beautifully for you right here across Bournemouth Pool in Christchurch in this gorgeous amphitheatre bay. You're going to see some high energy aerobatics with some graceful linking manoeuvres, and because the aircraft has a wide speed range, the display is going to be very tight to the crowd.
So leading the Petrie. If you hear him on the airwaves, you may detect a slight Canadian lilt. He was born across there, but to get across in the 70s. And must admit, a very relaxed man now. He spent many, many years in aviation through all sorts of aircraft. Instructor at Valley on Mark T2 Hawk. Some of you will have seen that on the television programme at the moment. And, but he also, at heart, a Tornado pilot.
The history of this wonderful, wonderful aircraft. First prototype Stratomaster flew in October.
I call this the GTI version of the J-Thing.
And just listen as this comes past, the Rolls-Royce Viper engine, it will give the Stratomaster 2,700 pounds of thrust. A beautiful sound. So nice to see the Stratomaster pair displaying here.
Stratomaster itself,
capable of operating from rough airstrips, and it was therefore widely used by third world nations. Initially marked as a counter-insurgency aircraft, the Stratomaster also maintained its advanced trainer profile, although most Middle Eastern users opted for the militarized version. A very clear semi-elliptical wing and the race cockpit, of course this design by Sydney Cam, also responsible for the amazing design, of course, of the Hurricane. And that race cockpit enabled the pilot to have better all-round visibility. It's a truly beautifully designed aircraft.
Now, as the real passion for this flying is so many others, of course, that's why he's across here this weekend flying this aircraft, but well-known amongst the Warbird community. Last saw him flying a Spitfire down at Goodwood, but he's well-known, of course, across in Dunsford as well. Like so many aircraft, though, this particular Seafury goes through so many different lives, so many different locations it has flown. In British terms, it was certainly the last big propeller aircraft.
So get your cameras ready for Falling Angels as they perform opposition pushovers and mirrored stall turns. So they fall back down to earth. They'll now fly directly towards us for the first braking manoeuvre. This is the crossfire brake. Moody clouds forming a perfect background.
Being the longest serving member of the Red Arrows for 10 years with the team and commentating
for 6 years. They'll fly each other now 350 miles an hour closer to speed, and they pass within only a matter of feet of each other. Now it's James and Andy's turn to take centre stage, eyes left and right, ladies and gentlemen. Speed.
Approaching each other, they'll put in a slight aileron roll. Cross over at the centre, they'll pull up to the vertical. And then they're going to idle. The power to weight ratio of this aeroplane is extraordinary, which gives it the ability to be able to do that hopper manoeuvre. It takes quite a lot of inspiration from our guest pilot, Gerald Cooper, who actually is the only pilot we have flying for the team. He's not flying with us today. But he's a multi-British aerobatic champion, and James and him have been getting their heads together quite a lot in the build-up to the start of the season to be able to perform these types of manoeuvres. Again, just hanging on the prop there and using the smoke to illustrate. That's really, really good. Look at that, right through the centre of it. That's very well flown. Using the smoke there just to illustrate how static the aircraft is in the air. So the team
has
the opportunity to put on that caution display we saw earlier. Flying these really delightful, easy, relaxed aircraft. They come out of the Vans company, RB4s. And a real pleasure to see these guys, and I think you'll just enjoy watching the graceful way that they fly, thinking in each other's brains, of course, formation flying of any today in its 40th year. Well, over 10,000 of these series of aircraft are now flying in 9 different variants. Build one of these yourself, just put it in the backyard, sell the Jaguar, or whatever you may have. It might cost you a few more, Bob, but you can certainly do it if you wish. You can even tailor them to your own particular ambitions. These particular aircraft were actually imported from across the pond in Baltimore and Houston before Andy and John put them together and set up their own flight display team, which has now been taken over, as you can see here today. And perfect synchronization, that's what it's all about. Harmony, graceful flying, nothing too dramatic here, although they've got the capability of being dramatic where they want to be, because they've got 160 horsepower by combing engines. They can fly anything between 50 and 200 miles an hour, and also pull up to +6 and -3 G. The baggage and plenty of fuel to nip across to France for a long weekend.
Most iconic aero engine ever built, but also the most instantly recognisable. And that radio call you hear.
Here's a great photo opportunity, ladies and gentlemen. That's just that perfect formation banking around.
See the Spitfire come downhill, ready to take over and start the first fighter class.
And the Spitfire you see today is MK356, built in Castle Bromwich, which is allocated to the newly formed 443 Hornet Squadron, Royal Canadian Air Force, at IF Digby in Lincolnshire, in March of 1944. She moved quickly to 144 Wing, to Homesley near Bournemouth, then to Westhampton, now also known as Goodwood, and later to Ford in Sussex.
Post-war, MK356 was used as an instructional airframe at Royal Air Force Horton until 1960, and the aircraft flew again for the first time in 53 years. Subsequently, joined the medium air. Many of you may not know, but actually we only have 2 full-time pilots working on the squadron. One is Officer Commanding Royal Air Force Battle of Britain Memorial Flight Squadron Leader Mark Fiskew. The other, our Officer Flight Attendant Andy Priest. All our other pilots work at many, many different other bases, and all do this as a secondary duty
and give up their time on weekends and look fine for themselves today.
You never see Mark break hard right, he's going to go over to crowd left, around 30 degrees, he's going to bring around back to line up for a victory roll, as we'll see the Hurricane passing below her. Something passed below her in the Hurricane. Blue sky above, that is a fantastic photo opportunity right there, ladies and gentlemen. And now I'm pleased to welcome squad leader Mark Sutton onto the display line, flying Hurricane.
It was a result of the foresight of Sweden for the need for a jet fighter that could intercept bombers at high altitude, but also engage fighters as well. Conceived in the period of the great F-104 Starfighter, that one often known as the Widowmaker, Saab Strachan would have to undertake a combat role unique to Sweden. Factory producing the MiG-15, one of the first successful swept-wing jet fighters and achieving fame
in the skies over Korea, where early in the war it outclassed all straight-wing enemy fighters in most applications. Sporting a new paint scheme for this season, painted black. Two aircraft will perform a series of formation display manoeuvres before then going into a dogfight scenario, and then two individual solo flypasts. Particular Polish-built MiG-15 following its service, which ended in 1990. It was exported to the USA and was based in Washington for some while before returning to Europe in 2014. Ken managed to get a collection of ex-Polish Air Force MiG-15 engineers to carry out the maintenance of it, and his passion relates to the shared border between the northeast of Norway and that of Russia. By the United Nations to the northwestern portion of North Korea during the Korean War, and it was the site of numerous dogfights between UN fighter pilots and their opponents from North Korea, including some unofficially crewed by Soviet airmen, but also by crews of the People's Republic of China. Our second
in service from the 50s to 2005. The Canadian version was powered by the Rolls-Royce Mean 10 turbojets. Canadair CT-133 was ultimate 19th into on contract to build T-33 shooting star trainers for the Royal Canadian Air Force power plant. The same Rolls-Royce Mean 10 turbojet used instead of the Addison J-33, which used by Lockheed in the production of the original T-33. The T-33 entered service in the Royal Canadian Air Force as its primary training
engine to see significant production. Whilst we're in the middle of the dogfight, it's worth noting that Mig Ali produced many fighter aces. The top aces for Russia was... And if he dips down, I was hoping he'd get the cockpit in towards you. To give you another chance to give him a wave off as well. But let's see how much time we can keep him in the circuit.
St. George, Tintin, very, very experienced. He's taken part in operations in Serbia, in Afghanistan and Libya, and he holds the rank of Lieutenant Colonel and was one of Norway's first F-35 pilots and the first Norwegian F-35 squadron commander based at Luke Air Force Base in the United States. Tintin joined the Norwegian Air Force Stealth Squadron in 2010 and has something of a real passion for flying these historical warbirds. Tintin acquired the Canadair T-33 in 2012 from the States and is a qualified display pilot on not only the aircraft you see here today but also the De Havilland Vampire. He's also a skilled commentator during many flying displays. And to take our jobs off of there, George. And he's logged more than 3,000 flight hours in the F-16 and has a total of more than 4,000 flying. We're very, very lucky to enjoy these fantastic aircraft in Bournemouth, George.
Real treat and in many ways absolutely extraordinary. Spoils really of both warbirds and vintage jets. A pleasure to see at a seaside air show. Sometimes these jets reserved for some of the more specialist air shows, but great pleasure. Thank you.
now very much coming towards the end of the display, pulling up. And you heard himself, Martin Tinton-Tesley. He says he wants to give you one more final pass. That'll be from the right-hand side. Pulling now into a bit of June descending. Again, all about energy, using this descent to get the speed up. And I hope you enjoyed that. Very, very different presentation, different display. Coming down now, he's looking at you. You're looking at him, giving a huge wave. On behalf of the Norwegian Air Force Historical Association, bidding his farewell now, Tinton-Tesley. Oh yes, look, give him a huge wave. Looking down, just checking you all out there. Come on, when have you gone?
They're travelling at 600 miles an hour. Fast pass to start the display. As you saw then, the reheat burning bright, that's 20,000 pounds of thrust per engine, pushing out,
so you can travel faster.
This aircraft is capable of up to 1.8 Mach,
which is roughly 1400 miles an hour.
And so he's made some adjustments from last year. This is one of his new things that he's changed.
The derring drive. Turn in, pull it up to 9G.
What it would. So in the cockpit, shifting the way, running, and starting, head, way, nearly 50 kilograms to the ground.
If you keep your eyes to the left, Jim will then accelerate up to only 600 miles an hour. And here it comes. And there he'll break away fully 90, and coming up the next maneuver, he'll do a 495 aerologically roll and push. Minus 3G, the effect that pushes the blood to his head. Look out for the trail of fuel coming from the tailpin.
Looks to be the first member of the team now, approaching the top. So let's see, test. Beautiful. talking to John earlier this morning, and he did ask us to make sure we passed on extreme thanks to Wave 105, for sponsoring this display for you today.
And
there we go.
Probably the most successful range of homebuilt aircraft in the world by many, many miles.
Well, over 10,000 of these various aircraft are now flying with 9 different variants of them. You can put one of these together in your own backyard. Well, maybe it's not a bad one, but they are indeed delightful aircraft to fly. I think it's time to give them all away before they break away to our left.
As I've already mentioned then, this is the display captain, this squadron leader John Turner.
His name is JT. JT joined the Royal Air Force in 1993. He was posted to our program in Washington in 1998. He's flown operations in Bosnia, Sierra Leone, Iraq and Afghanistan.
And most recently he was out in the Caribbean in 2017, undertaking hurricane relief support.
Joining JT in the cockpit today, 2019 display co-pilot, Flight Lieutenant Alan Berry. Alan joined the Royal Air Force in 2008,
subsequently to DC's Rotary Flying Training.
He joined the Chinook Force in 2015, meeting operations in Iraq, and more recently served from Operation Neutron in support of our friend and ally out in Mali. Now the aircraft out to my right hand side, your right hand side. They're going to pull up for a 30 degree SX. Right hand wing over. This is got JT looking out the right hand side of the aircraft.
And one mic display on and he stays here as he brings the aircraft back around.
Sends to the correct height and brings it back up to speed. And she runs back along today, ladies and gentlemen. You can hear that waffle waffle, that famous sound of the Chinook. Synonymous for the aircraft, and it leads to our Twitter hashtag. Led to his death just along the coast here in Christchurch in 1910. His name is Simon Oxley, with all those famous Merlin engines, that indeed, of course, many others since his death, but He was attending the very first international air display in Christchurch, flying a light flyer, would you believe?
In the Strike Master Pen.
Half across the 6 o'clock here for the Strike Master Pen today. Martin Ollie, really looking forward to this morning, really looking forward to this game too, for the final time here in Bournemouth. The display we're going to see today is very going. It's going to show off his aircraft beautifully, be right there in Bournemouth. We're going to see some high energy aerobatics with some graceful winking manoeuvres. And because this aircraft has a wide speed range, the display is going to be tight to you.
Services. Celebration this year, his 33rd birthday. Half of Fury is designed to an RAF response at a light tempo. They weren't going to see with this aircraft, and in favour of waiting to do this with the jet.
Already a UK display
Merritt for the work he did last year using his Norwegian Vampire to support RF 100 with a special paint scheme. But here today is something completely different. His representation of what was called Make Adam. This year, a Korean War scenario
featuring the incredible MiG-15 and new paint scheme painted black alongside the Canadair T-33 shooting star. So aircraft will perform a formation display and then go into a dogfight scenario
as well as individual solo displays in remembrance of the air war over Korea. Where early in the war, it outclassed all straight-wing
enemy fighters in most applications.
Formation. These guys are all great chums putting this together.
Quite a treat it is. Listening to three different sections, what we're going to see here today
is another masterclass in close formation flying. Took an awful lot of time building up this show though, because of course,
different weights, different speeds, different regimes, and getting the formation elements absolutely key. But a lot of work put into it.
So now,
a series of four-ship formation passes, first of all, diving down as a formation, flying around three...
Whatever you've got, hats, coats, somebody, you know the score, ice creams, just give them a massive wave as they just did it.
A little bit over to give you a bit of a topside view.
Eight pilots, eight aircraft, the most unique formation, beautiful. The ultimate warbird,
together with the blades.
From John Gowdy there in the background saying that was great fun guys, we're now splitting formation.
Ladies, you're on your own. To tell you all about this extraordinary team, please now more formally welcome Arthur Williams.
Thanks very much, George.
What a fantastic display that was. Oh, I love that point. This is a dip the formation into sun now. We've got a beautiful glimpse of the to tell you about this. Please welcome
Mike Rockets.
Good luck,
This is Flight Manager Houston, second year, and starting this new sequence is Mysterium Flying.
I'm going to be a DRT. You're made up of dedicated users.